21 years ago, two college classmates from DLSU defied gravity, going against the current that was the Asian financial crisis to start a construction company. And it succeeded. 14 years later, going public. It has since won major infrastructure projects for government, from building schools and an airport. And note, this could soon become plural. Now, that company is Megawide, making headlines over the past weeks with its own bid to fix NAIA. Today, we talk to the men behind the super company, Megawide Chairman and CEO Edgar Saavedra, Louis Ferrel, the President of GMR-Megawide, Cebu Airport Corporation, the developer of Mactan Cebu Airport, and Chief Executive Advisor of GMCAC, Andrew Harrison. Good morning, gentlemen. Thank you for joining us.
Good morning.
So early in the morning and on Monday. Yes. So I want to start with this. 4 years ago, Megawide GMR bagged the Mactan Cebu International Airport with a 17.5 billion peso bid. At that time, you were going up against the much bigger, much more established PhilInvest, partnered with Changi. At that time, people, at least from our end, from journalists' perspective, we were comparing your story to David and Goliath. You were the newcomer, you were the new kid on the block, but you won. Today, you submitted last week a proposal for the NAIA rehabilitation, and you're going up against seven of the country's largest conglomerates. Are you still David? Do you still feel like a David in this case?
Yes, we feel like David. We feel like, you know, it's the same story, but this is much larger. This is the NAIA after all. But and we have so much admiration. We have so much respect for the members of the super consortium, mm-hmm. and we admire that they're coming together. But more than the competition, we'd like to focus on the project. We were studying this project for 2 years already. 2 years back, the government announced that they're open to an unsolicited bid. So we started a research on the project. We brought in MITRE to help us in the technical analysis. Mm-hmm. So we'd like to just focus on the project.
Mm-hmm. Andrew, what makes your proposal the better proposal?
Well, I think what makes it better, or certainly what we believe makes it a more mm-hmm. compelling case, is that, of course, it gives the government a choice mm-hmm. Of which type of option it wants. But the shortest concession period so far at 18 years, a guarantee that within 6 years, all of the airside congestion and terminal capacity issues at NAIA will be fully addressed. Mm-hmm. In fact, they'll be addressed in the first 4 years, wow. so by the fourth year. Mm-hmm. The last 2 years, or the fifth and sixth year, are actually about building future capacity mm-hmm. so that over the 18-year concession period and potentially beyond, NAIA is never constrained. Mm-hmm. So the numbers are 60 air traffic movements per hour, mm-hmm. which is virtually a 50% increase over where we are today, mm-hmm. a terminal capacity of 72 million passengers per annum, which is, again, a much larger number than where we are today.
It's double.
Yes, it is double, correct, yes. Mm-hmm. And this all within a concession period of 18 years for the equivalent of 150 billion pesos. Mm-hmm. And we believe it's a very compelling case. Mm-hmm. We certainly believe that the real potential of unlocking the congestion in NAIA is to focus on the airside constraints and at the same time in parallel increase the terminal capacity. And while doing so, introduce world-class standards mm-hmm. so that we take our rightful place as one of the major hubs in the ASEAN region.
And you plan to do this without building a third runway?
Yes.
That is the major difference between your proposal and the super consortium's proposal.
Yes. Well, I think there are many differences, but the runway is one of them. We considered the runway at the very outset, and we believe quite firmly that a third runway is out of the question.
Why?
Because firstly, where will you put the third runway? The third runway, because of the wind direction, the prevailing wind direction, can only be in parallel to one of the two existing runways. Now, there's no space for you to do that because you're basically landlocked. You have residential developments, you have the airport infrastructure. So the only place to put a third runway is in Manila Bay. Now, if you put it out in the middle of Manila Bay, how do you get to it? Mm-hmm. Let's take the example of Amsterdam Schiphol. Amsterdam built their sixth runway, which has a journey time of 7 kilometers, or journey distance of 7 kilometers from landing to get to the terminal building. That's mm-hmm. 25 minutes of taxi time. We believe it would be even more than that if the runway is built in Manila Bay.
Oh, wow.
And there are environmental considerations as well. So it makes it completely unviable. And the other greater point to consider is that any new runway would conflict with the existing runway. So the net result would either be no increase in capacity or potentially a marginal reduction in capacity. Mm-hmm. So there's no value for the third runway in that sense. Mm-hmm. We believe that unlocking the constraints, looking at airside improvements, construction of rapid exit taxiways, full-length parallel taxiways, is how to unlock the congestion, which will give us 60 ATMs or air traffic movements per hour.
Mm-hmm. And you guys are coming in with a partner. You're still with, it's a Megawide GMR consortium.
Yes.
GMR, of course, is your partner in the Mactan Cebu International Airport. So it's a tried and tested partnership already. And you're coming up with MITRE Corporation as your technical advisor. But the super consortium, I just want to compare, they're teaming up with Changi Airport. Mm. And we know that Changi Airport is known as a world-class airport aviation expert. It's like bringing in a partner, a Rolls-Royce for a partner. What do you say to that when people ask you about the partnerships?
Well, one thing I'd like to say is that, yes, we recognize, we respect Changi, but equally, GMR is also in that league. We have challenged them, and very soon, we'll get to know the results of the latest airport service quality survey, which looks at the global ranking of airports in terms of service quality as voted by the passengers who travel through the airports. Mm-hmm. So that news will be out very shortly and we'll see where we stand in the rankings. Mm-hmm. But I can tell you we are in the same category, competing in the same category with airports like Changi, Incheon and Hong Kong. So from that perspective, I guess there's really no difference. But yes, certainly more people from the Philippines who would have traveled through Changi, perhaps more so than Delhi. But I can say one thing. I believe that we have a tried and tested formula because we have the experience of building this infrastructure and the people capability. Mm-hmm. Because let's not forget, an airport is not just about glass and steel and wood. Mm-hmm. It's about the people who live there, who work there, developing their potential, developing their capability. And being that the Philippines has this warmth and hospitality within its people, we're the third happiest population in the world. Where else would you want to build an airport? So mm-hmm. we have that advantage over China.
And how will this project, if you guys win it, how will you be funding it? Louis, I know you're in charge of the finances here.
No.
Or Ed.
So basically it's a 70-30, so it will be 70% funded by the creditors.
Okay.
So 30% will be equity. So normally we will have a special purpose vehicle for every project. Mm-hmm. So, and it's 60-40 between Megawide and GMR.
Oh, wow. Okay. And I know I asked you this earlier. Your first love really is construction.
Yes.
Before you got into infrastructure, you were the construction guys. How much of your business is construction now and how much is infrastructure?
Yeah, in terms of top line right now, the construction is still composed of about 80 to 85% of the top line. But on the bottom line, construction will be around 60%.
Oh, wow.
So, as you know, when we started joining the infrastructure four or five years ago, we saw the opportunity that this is the time we're in. We want to bring in our expertise in engineering and constructions. Mm-hmm. And you have seen the growth. We were able to sustain the growth to compete with the big ones because we were able to bring in the technology, the know-how. That's where we're good at, apart from just purely constructions. We helped build the government, the 10,000 classroom. So we were able to, we're part of the government in bringing down the backlog from 60,000 classroom to 12,000.
Oh, wow.
So we built 10,000 in less than 3 years. So, and that time, most of all the bidders, they declined, they backed out on during the bid because the budget given by the government was very low. Mm-hmm. So, but we still pursued the projects and won it. So the other, then we moved to Mactan. Then what we did, the model is we partnered with the expert like GMR. So, but we won it competitively, mm-hmm. and even the other projects like the ITS, the bus terminal, mm-hmm. we bidded like 300 million below our next bidder. Even the Clark, the recently, we bidded 26% below the government budget and 13% below the second lowest bidder. So we have always been very cost competitive and we deliver on time and the quality as expect more than the expectation of the government and the public.
So it's not just about the size of the war chest. It's not just about the money.
No. Yes, yes.
Because you're bringing the technology to make it more.
Yes, and we can always bring in the right partner, whether the expertise or financially, who can also help us.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. In fact, that's actually my point for NAIA. With our experience in Mactan, we understand the Filipinos, how they travel, what is a peak season, what are their behavior during peak season. You know, Filipinos like bringing their barangay, right, when they travel. And that's similar to India as well. GMR, we value the experience of GMR. They've transformed one of the worst airports in the world to consistently one of the top five airports.
And this is which
And this
airport?
Is Delhi.
Delhi Airport. Yes.
Mm-hmm. So it's more than the size. It's actually the experience also.
This experience with Mactan, it's the second busiest gateway in the country. It's a major hub. Mm. What did you learn from that experience that you think you bring to the table now that you're offering to, you know, fix NAIA, which is the main gateway? It's a different ballgame altogether, I understand. Mm. NAIA is NAIA. It's the capital. It's the showpiece of the country.
I think it is, but the most important thing about an airport, there's no dark science about managing an airport. Managing an airport is all about understanding your customer and putting yourself in the shoes of your customer. I'll give you an example. The most important aspect of an element of an airport is not the runway, it's not the parking stands, it's the washroom. Because if you have a lousy experience in the washroom, it doesn't matter how good or how efficient the airport actually runs.
You actually have a study that shows this?
Absolutely. I had a question. Somebody asked me, why is it that there are female-only washrooms in the existing airport in Mactan? And I said, it's because we did a statistical count, a survey, to determine washroom dwell times. And of course, ladies spend more time in the washroom than men, and there are more female travelers during peak times. And that's why we have that equation. So things like that are important. I mean, that's just one example. The taxi experience. How do people choose taxi or onward transportation? It's one of the things we did in Mactan. We centralized everything to make it easier. You choose how much time you have and how deep your pockets are. Do you want a yellow cab, white cab, or a bus? So signage, wayfinding, giving people directions, and ease of connectivity. These are things that doesn't matter the scale of the airport, whether it's NAIA or Mactan. So long as we can understand the needs of the people, put ourselves in their shoes, we can bring the solutions. And what we've learned in Mactan is what we will bring to NAIA. Mm-hmm. But of course, on a much larger scale.
Much larger scale. Ed, you were
going to say? Yes. I'd like to add to that. Even working with the LGUs and how to promote the tourism, like in Mactan, we don't
I think we have a video of Mactan Airport.
We promote Mactan as a destination. Mm-hmm. So if you look at the tourist growth in Mactan, when we took over, there was a significant improvement in the tourist arrivals in Mactan. You try to check in any hotels in Cebu right now, you could hardly get a room.
Wow.
Yeah.
And that's what you... So I want to go back to the NAIA rehabilitation. Many of my friends, when they heard this news, they were asking, so when they fix NAIA, will they be closing down operations of some parts?
No. Actually,
what is the game
our
plan?
Proposal, the way our proposal works, is that terminals 1 and 2 will be combined as one terminal.
Okay.
And terminal 3 will be expanded, almost 3-4 times its current capacity. Mm-hmm. And the way in which we do this is we construct on either side of existing operations. And then we do the rehabilitation once we move people into the newly constructed segments. Mm-hmm. So virtually there is no disruption to operations whilst we do this construction. And that was part of the consideration in our plan. Because the airport's already congested, what people don't want is for you to turn it into a construction site, you know, whilst it's congested.
And I want to talk about expansion plans very quickly. Do you plan to move overseas? I mean, to do business overseas?
Well, right now we want to focus Philippines. Mm-hmm. As you know, our build program of this administration, we want to be part of that.
And you were a big player in the PPP space, but government now is shifting more towards the ODA-funded projects. What do you think about that?
Oh, it's not really. It's the same. It's the matter of the modality, how they tender out the project. Mm. But basically, if you look at the list of the projects they have, on the ODA comprise only around less than 20%. Mm-hmm.
So still exciting, still big room for companies like you.
Yes, although that's one of our advantages because we can participate as a concessionaire or just an EPC player.
So logistics. It seems like the next step. It makes sense. Metro Pacific is doing it. Are you guys keen on?
We want to, because the infrastructure space now is pretty big, we want to focus on that one, mm-hmm. where we can bring in our expertise.
And finally, I want to ask this, Ed Louis, do you sometimes feel, I mean, it's been 21 years since this company was formed, do you sometimes feel that Megawide is growing too fast, too soon?
That has always been the case since we started. But so far, we're still here, and we're still growing even faster.
Mm-hmm. And I guess that's how it is for trailblazer companies.
Yes, we feel that, but it's only now also that we're experiencing so many projects in the Philippines. The past decades, we never had this big infrastructure projects.
Mm. Exciting times ahead. Thank you very much, gentlemen, and good luck.
Thank you.